Have fun doing what you do. It's not work. It's fun. So we can do it on the road. We can do it at home. We can do it anywhere we at.
Take the party with you. Yeah. Let's get a little bit of history. Let's go back in time a little bit before we talk about what's going on now. But first of all, congratulations on your new single, which we're going to jump into in a moment.
I'm going to make you sick of me.
You know, where to start? I mean, I was looking at this last night trying to figure out where I start with this because your history is just so enormous and so big and your influence. But let's talk about Parliament Funkadelic. Let's talk about what you set out to do at the beginning, because you mixed up a whole bunch of stuff that had never really been put together before.
Well, we started out wanting to be Frankie Lyman and the Teenagers. Okay, that's a little far back. Well, let's say we started out wanting to be the Temptations. I think you probably remember that, right?
Sure.
So we did that. We were Motown, we was on Motown, we did the R&B. But we wasn't the right height, you know. We had to be 6 feet, everybody.
Right.
We looked like steps. So we never made it that way. So let's get funky. Once you get funky, you can look like anything.
So you started off doing doo-wop, as you
that's
mentioned,
what I'm
right?
We were doo-wopping like the Temptations, making love songs. Baby, please, I get on my knees for you.
tell me a little bit about all of you. We'll go along the line about your earliest musical recollections, your first exposure to music, when you felt it for the first time and thought, this is something that makes me feel something.
The Beatles did it for me, actually. I was old enough to see the Beatles on Ed Sullivan. And seeing that just inspired me to want to do what they were doing.
But can you remember the feeling? I mean, you see that on a little TV.
Oh, man, just excited. You know what I mean? I was a little kid. My mother and father had a black and white TV. And everybody knew they was coming to town. It was a big thing. And we was just hyped. And, you know, and they were all what we expected them to be.
Right.
Everything.
They just must have looked so weird, though, compared with everything else that was going on.
For kids like me, that was, like, not weird. That was, like, what was going to be next. So,
right.
Happy to see that.
Weird was the look in the 60s.
Sure.
You went out of your way to be weird.
Right.
You had an ambition to be weird. You tried to be weirder than the next one. That was the thing. You tried to be as unlike anybody else, you know, to the point we ran around with sheets and diapers on. We were grown men. That shit wasn't cute. You know what I'm saying? It wasn't like we were trying to be cute. We chased people out of the club. I mean, and we had an ambition that was like a mark on our thing. We could scare the hell out of somebody. You know?
Well, let me ask Blackbird, what about you? What was your first introduction to music?
The first introduction that I recall was laying in my crib, listening to the likes of Miles Davis, Modern Jazz Messengers, Art Blakey, and Train, music like that. Playing Sam Cooke. It wasn't as much visual as it was.
What you were hearing. What about the bass? What drew you to the bass?
What about the bass?
Yeah.
Yeah, Pop had the big Magnavox stereo with the extra speaker.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
So
I do.
I had a good.
Yeah. When was it something you figured you wanted to do?
Dad says about age 5 or 6.
Pretty early. You were locked in.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's why you're so bad now. You've been doing that shit for a long time.
But you started off with a band with your cousin, right? Is that right? Somebody did. Blackbird, I thought. No.
No.
All right, I got my information wrong. Tell me about your first band.
First band was junior high school. We would call it Total Concept Unlimited. Deep. We played everything, rhythm and blues, but with me being in a band, if we did not play Bag and Brain, I quit.
Right. like you
to do. We had to play something fucking dumb.
Yeah. So how'd that work out for you, that first band?
He's in Funkadelic. I left.
I'm getting my wires crossed. Elias, you were in a band with your cousin, is that right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Me and Mike Hant and Kid Funkadelic. And we met George and the crew in 74. And we had a band going on in Cleveland, Ohio. That's why I'm wearing all this
Canadian
and stuff.
Yes.
I'm a Cleveland guy. But yeah, and then basically we ran into them guys. We didn't know that it would turn out the way it did, but we were Funkadelic fans. We were trying to be Funkadelics way before we actually got anointed by Mr. George Clinton. So.
Sure. Yeah.
In other words, we stole it from their parents.
So,
and he helped us sneak Mike out of town.
Yeah. We ended up getting a call from George in around 74. And Mike was called to go out. And the first show, I think, was Capitol Center in Washington, D.C. But I had to sneak him out. I had the car. So I drove him to the airport. So we had to do all of this undercover because we were still like 15, 16 years old, you know, and our parents didn't know.
So I mentioned at the beginning of this about all the stuff you threw into the mix. Obviously, funk, psychedelia, a big dose of...
That's psychedelic.
A big...
Funkadelic is what we call it.
A big dose of humor, though. Always a part of the mix,
right? Always fun. I mean, we were funny looking in the first place. So we had to make sure, we had to make it look like we meant to be funny. You know, we started out trying to be cool. You know, we sharp as shit. As soon as we hit the stage and the people weren't moving right, fuck that, ties coming off. You know, give me some towel over somebody's table. I cut a hole in it, put my head through it, take my clothes off under it, and run around flashing people.
Well, that's going to get your attention, right?
I was definitely going to get your attention. The music was there. We had Eddie Hazel, Billy Bates, Bernie Worrell. We were playing some shit, and we got your attention. We wasn't going to let you go. So my job was to get you to say, what the fuck are they doing? And we always succeeded at that. And to this day, they're still trying to figure out what we do. We trying to figure it out. You know, every time I hear something from somebody that I like, I want to do that. Like I said, today I hear Cardi B, I want to be Cardi B.
Yeah.
I mean, that shit is the bad shit this year. You know? And I ain't got no shame. You know, back in the day, you call it teeny bopper or whatever the youngsters were. That was your way of getting out, that they was getting more action than you. But once you get a little older, you realize, shit, when I go back and do that, I just can't think I'm so deep that I got to stay out here with all these folks that ain't gonna buy no records, who ain't gonna dance, who ain't going to the club. The kids is the one that's gonna be doing that, so I try to figure out what the hell they doing.
How important was it to you then, as well as now, obviously, but then at the beginning, to get people dancing?
Like I said, once we realized that's what it was, that's what it was about, we could do that easily. You know, the other thing was trying to be cute and try to outdo the Temptation. That wasn't working. We could sing it, but wasn't nothing happening on the visuals. So once we know that if we having a party, people are going to get jealous, they want to party with you. So when we hit the stage, we play for each other. We can jam in favor of two people in the audience. We gonna play like everybody's there. And that pretty much worked for us. We don't care if you like it or not. You most likely gonna like it because we like it.
I remember, and feel free to jump in on this, guys, but I remember interviewing a younger man.